Excelente. Así que ya podemos dar inicio.
Now we're ready with the interpreting and we can get started. Are you ready, Ricardo? Yes, we're ready. Good morning, everyone. I am Nadia Monge Hernandez. You have, as most of you know, I'm part of the coordinating team for the challenge, the Rural Youth Challenge for the hemisphere-wide community of rural youth. And I am very excited and pleased about today's session because with us are our friends from 4-H, Hannah Bolton and Logan Emery. They are leaders in this organization from different parts of Canada, Ontario, and British Columbia. Today, they are going to talk to us about a number of important considerations for young people to get involved in building strong communities. First, I will introduce Hannah. Hannah has been a very active member of 4-H for 15 years. During this time, she has participated in many programs on provincial communication, youth action. She's been a delegate for different 4-H events, including the 2017 Global 4-H Network Summit. Right now, she is studying for her bachelor's degree in agricultural science at the University in Alberta, specializing in animal science. And she's also part of the Ceres Alberta Women's Fraternity. It is an organization of women working toward closer ties among women in agriculture. I will also introduce our other speaker, our friend Logan Emery. He is also from the Youth Advisory Committee of 4-H, along with Hannah, but he is from Ontario. Logan holds a Bachelor of Science in Agriculture from the University of Guelph in Canada and is currently managing a dairy farm with his family in Northern Ontario. He has extensive background in international agriculture and youth development. He has traveled all over the world, including trips to Costa Rica, Panama, and Cuba to learn by doing at every step along the way. So having said that, I would now invite Hannah and Logan to go ahead with your presentation. We are listening.
My name is Hannah Bolton and I live in Cranbrook, British Columbia. Currently, I am in my third year of pursuing a degree in Bachelor of Science in Agriculture, majoring in Animal Science from the University of Alberta. The last two summers, I have worked locally at Bayer Crop Science Parent Seed Office. At Bayer, I learned about canola and spinach. I am going into my 15th year of Highland Dancing, and I have my first level of Highland Dance teachers. So that means like I dance with bagpipes and I wear a kilt and I dance over swords sometimes. For dance, I have competed across North America. So that includes like Toronto, Nashville, San Diego. And I also, one of my first international competitions was in Nassau, Bahamas. I have also been involved with 4-H for 15 years. I started 4-H at the age of 6 as a clover bud, which is the youngest age category for 4-H. When I was old enough, I tried out many projects like honeybees, crafts, ambassador, market hog, and market beef. Three projects that I gravitated towards were Market Hog, Market Beef, and being a 4-H BC ambassador. I have taken advantage of all opportunities that have been offered through 4-H, which has allowed me to travel throughout BC and across Canada. Through 4-H, I have deepened my appreciation for agriculture and my community. In 2017, I became a 4-H BC ambassador for the Kootenay region. Through this position, I promoted 4-H to my community and to the general public. After I completed my term as ambassador, I applied to be the BC representative for 4-H Canada's Youth Advisory Committee and started at the beginning of 2020. Through YAC, I have contributed to youth's perspective in meetings and promotional platforms. I am part of the 4-H Canada's conference working group right now for YAC, so I will be helping facilitate a national conference later this year with Logan. On to you,
Thanks
Logan.
Thanks a lot, Hannah, and that's definitely a great introduction. Hi, everybody. Thank you very much for joining us today. We're really excited to join you for this double ICA presentation. As it was mentioned, my name is Logan Emery. I'm a recent graduate of the University of Guelph. I just graduated this spring, kind of during COVID, with my Bachelor of Science in Agriculture as well. I grew up on a dairy farm in Northern Ontario where my family farms and have farmed here for over 100 years now. We run a dairy operation that milks about 120 dairy cows, and are currently in the process of splitting into two separate businesses so that myself and my father can operate one side of the farm, and my uncle and my cousin can operate the other side of the farm. As it was mentioned, I have an extensive experience in international agriculture and youth engagement. I'll touch on that a little bit more later, but it's one of the main focuses that I'm going to bring to this call today. It was mentioned that I've done some trips abroad. I spent a week last year in Costa Rica, which is a beautiful country, and I understand that today here we have lots of participants from Costa Rica. So welcome to all of you, and thank you for your country's hospitality last year. Pura vida. As well, in the 4-H program, I'm in my 11th year now. So this is my final year of 4-H, and I started 4-H when I was just 10 years old, which was the age limit in Ontario at the time. As a member, I mostly focused on dairy, which obviously relates back to my background in agriculture and farming, but also did square dancing as one of my other main 4-H projects, which I really enjoyed. Outside of those two, though, I did bounce around from a lot of different other projects, including life skills clubs like sewing and cooking, sports clubs. I've done running and winter outdoors clubs, things like that. But I've really tried to grasp and learn as much in the 4-H program as I can. As well, I've taken plenty of opportunities to travel through 4-H. That this has led me to three different continents with 4-H alone, and many different provinces and countries, meeting 4-H members along the way and making great connections. As well, like Hannah, I'm the Youth Advisory Committee representative for Ontario, which is my province here in Canada. I've been in this position now for just over 3 years, or approaching 3 years, I should say, and this is my third and final year on the committee, where I represent our full committee as the chair. As well, I've helped to run conferences for 4-H Canada, like our National Members Forum, where youth congregate from across the country, and we'll be alongside Hannah this December as we help to plan 4-H Canada's Citizenship Congress, another national event, and we're both really excited for that. So that's a little bit of my background, and now I'll give you a bit more of an understanding of 4-H if you aren't familiar with the program already. So 4-H is a positive youth development organization, and it really focuses on letting members get in and get their hands dirty. Learn to do by doing by hands-on activities and developing life skills, leadership skills through activities where they can participate. 4-H might have a bit of a different name. I know that in Costa Rica it's called 4S, or it might have different mottos or a different pledge in different countries, but in the 75 countries, more than 75 countries worldwide, 4-H has a very similar platform of focusing on youth development through a learn to do by doing. And that really just means that we're focused on allowing youth to develop their skills and learn from their mistakes by trying activities firsthand. Now, Hannah will take you through what the 4-H Canada pledges and what the 4-H's are.
So we have a pledge with 4-H, and this pledge is like the base, like the background for 4-H, and the 4-H's really resonate with 4-H members, as this is what they strive to work towards in their 4-H program. So my head to clearer thinking, this is for managing and thinking. My heart to greater loyalty, for relating and caring. My hands to larger service, for giving and working. My health to better living, for my club, my community, my country, and my world. So that would be like for being and for living. So now Logan's going to talk about a little more about our positions as YAC members.
So as both of us have mentioned, in 4-H Canada, we have a National Youth Advisory Committee. And so that means that there's a committee of youth who are engaged at the national level from across our country who all work towards similar goals. So our Youth Advisory Committee is made up of 10 representatives, which you can see here in this picture, along with one of our sponsors in the middle. Each one of us represent our own province. So for myself, that's Ontario, and for Hannah, that's British Columbia. And we represent our province at the national level. Our Youth Advisory Committee also works on several different things for the 4-H Canada program, including different programs like Members Forum and Citizenship Congress that we've talked about a little bit already, as well as resources that go out to our members, marketing and communication materials like this that we're on right now. This call is a different marketing communication tool that 4-H Canada uses to reach out to networks across the globe. As well, we have two representatives who sit on 4-H Canada's board of directors, and that really helps give the program in Canada a youth voice to make sure that active members still are helping run the program and have that voice at the national level. Part of the 4-H program, as we've mentioned, is learning to do by doing. And 4-H being a youth-focused program, it's really important that youth have these opportunities to represent themselves and make a difference in the program that they've learned so much from. And I think that's both why Hannah and I have gotten into this position. I'll hand it over to Hannah now, and she's gonna talk a little bit about her 4-H career and how it has helped strengthen her youth communities and her commitment to the communities she is in.
Yes, thank you, Logan. So there are some things people say that just stick. They are the quotes that start as just words and then become actions. From a very young age, I always heard family members tell me, what you put in is what you get out, meaning how much you actually do and how the effort you put in will reflect what you get out, what you achieve, and where you end up. So then, in the next slide, a few years into 4-H, I started to hear about different opportunities through 4-H, like participating in conferences about leadership, career building, and agriculture. Somewhere along the way, I got told that there would be a cost to attend these conferences, and I needed to figure out how to pay for them. Usually the cost of conferences were only an eighth or a very small portion of the actual cost, as the conferences were heavily sponsored. As I was only 9 when I started and had my first market hog project, I soon realized that raising a pig, I would have some costs, then a potential for a profit. This sparked an idea that I could raise more pigs for spending money. The spending money would be used to attend 4-H conferences. When I was in high school, I really contemplated applying for a part-time job, as it seemed like it was what everyone my age was doing. At that point, I was selling 6 to 7 pigs and 1 steer per year. I put in the time and effort to have well-mannered animals for 4-H competitions and producing a good product. I calculated the total I was earning, and this was more than most of my peers were making working for a part-time job at minimum wage. I weighed my pros and cons of me applying for a part-time job, though I decided against getting a job. I already had a job. It had great hours, I had repeat customers, and I was gaining experience in the career path I wanted to pursue. From this experience, I found something that was interesting to me, and I could provide a product to sell. Today, I still have repeat customers from my first sale. I put in time and effort to have a great product for my customers. From that, I have gained experience and the ability to pursue different opportunities. So coming from a small community like Cranbrook, excelling in like a smaller community is far different than going into a larger center, like a big fish in a little pond. This can be taken into context whether traveling to a new country, attending a conference, or competing in a competition. Cranbrook is located in the southeast corner of British Columbia in the Kootenay region. So you can see it's in the yellow part of BC. We are surrounded by mountains. This creates a seclusion from the rest of the province. When I was 15 years old, I had my first opportunity to travel outside of my region with 4-H. The opportunity was to compete in provincial communication finals. The way of the competition was conducted, competitors toured 3 farms that were around a specific theme. That theme would later be revealed through the impromptu speech topic, and the length of the speech had to be around 3 to 5 minutes long. I had no clue what to expect when competing outside of my region and at a totally new level of competition. The last time someone from my club had gone was several years before, and my only memory of his experience was him saying he toured farms, but when he got to this impromptu speech topic, the only thing he could remember was at one of the farms, they had a pet moose. And so he made his whole speech on this pet moose. Fast forward to my speech, the topic was success of generations of family farming. I learned so much from in my experience, as I had no clue what to expect. And I was competing with members that were close to 8 years older than me. The best part was I had fun and learned a lot. By observing the other competitors, I learned to watch how I use up space and take up more space on the stage, talking into a microphone and seeing different speaking styles. This gave me the want to improve and do better, not only to improve myself, but improve the experience for 4-H members in my region and help them prepare to speak at a provincial level of competition and promote traveling with 4-H and taking advantage of opportunities available. Still competed since then, I competed twice at provincial communication finals. 2 more members since then have competed from my region, and many more have participated and other 4-H opportunities. So I mentioned that I was a 4-H BC ambassador. So my term was 2 years long and it started in 2017. When I started, at first, there wasn't that much information that I received from other members about how their experience was as a 4-H ambassador, because nobody really had been an ambassador for a couple years. And I was too young to remember anything that they actually had done. So I only knew what 4-H BC expected of me, which was completing 10 events each year for 2 years. These events could range from promotional, so like going on the radio or doing articles for our local newspaper, to organizing and hosting events or like moderating or facilitating a conference at a provincial level. I found it difficult to get help. No one really understood that this was important to me to meet my goals. My goals were to surpass those 20 events and improve participation of 4-H members locally. This was a huge learning curve for me, as I had to really think outside of the box. This was also the difference between proactive and reactive thinking. Proactive meaning making events happen for me, while reactive meaning waiting for others to ask and guide me through the process. I chose to be proactive. So during my 4-H ambassador term, I went forward with writing articles about 4-H, going to clubs fairs to promote 4-H. The biggest event I organized was for my club's participation in a local parade, and we had a petting zoo afterwards. That day, I was invited on our local radio station to promote 4-H. From that point on, I became a regular. I have spoken on the radio many times over the past 5 years. Recently, I was introducing our new 4-H BC ambassador to our community. One of my favorite events that I did during my time as an ambassador was 4-H for a Day program. I noticed that they were doing these programs all over BC, but the Kootenays did not really have that program going on. It was a day-long program where kids that had no experience with 4-H and wanted a summer camp experience of 4-H in one day. So I shrunk that program down to an hour and asked two organizations if I could come in and talk to their youth camps about 4-H. And so these two organizations were BCSPCA and the Boys and Girls Club. So I went in multiple times to SPCA and I went into the Boys and Girls Club and I gave this presentation on what 4-H is, what's happening, what kind of projects you can enroll in, and what opportunities are there for different youth. And I also had a bunch of games, a lot of prizes, and a lot of team building activities. When I completed my term, I had completed over 50 events and won an award for being the outstanding ambassador, as I completed the most events of all 4-H BC ambassadors in my term. So really, I chose to be proactive, making goals and working towards them. Now my region knows what is expected and promotes the 4-H BC ambassador program to members. Currently, we have a new 4-H BC ambassador that has taken my place, and I am so excited to see what's in store for her. I put in 100%, and you can decide what I got out of it. One thing I would like to touch on is that I have always had a busy schedule. I thrive with being busy. A regular week for me includes remote classes, meetings, dance classes, and lots of studying. Like right now, I'm in midterm season and started my midterms yesterday and will probably go all the way until the end of November. So that's just a regular week for me, though I have found out the last couple years that there is a fine line between being too busy and overcommitting and just being busy. I have always tried to take advantage of every opportunity, but realizing halfway through that it is too much, that's never good. I try to make sure that I am taking care of myself. For me, this means dancing regularly for exercise, taking mental breaks, like going outside and spending time with my animals. I am the only one that knows my limits, making me in control of saying yes or no. I know for me that if I overcommit, I stress and panic, which means I lose sight of my goals and most likely terms that I should be remembering for my exams. I realize I still have a lot to improve on, and I know I'm still learning when to say yes or no. You can see in this picture, it's me with waterfalls. This is to Kakwa Falls at Yoho National Park. 2 summers ago, I wrote my chemistry final in July, which I had to travel 4 hours to the closest Proctor Center. On my way home, we took a scenic route and checked out the falls. This was the perfect stress reliever after my final exam. So from taking something my parents had always said to me, what you put in is what you get out, and applying it to my goals, like earning money to go towards 4-H trips, such as Youth Action. In this picture, this is at Youth Action with my small group. It was the perfect small group to work through all the different things that we did during this conference, as the theme was leadership. And if you look in this picture, it may just be a few faces, but if you look really closely, there are more than a few 4-H BC ambassadors and 4-H alumni in there. There is two YAC members actually in this picture, one a previous and then me, and then others have gone on with university degrees, and everybody has succeeded and shown their leadership in different ways. So I have made choices to get closer to my goals. I chose to be proactive rather than reactive. An example of this is when I was 4-H BC ambassador and having to choose how I was going to achieve my goals. I enjoy being busy, but there is a fine line of getting a lot done and being too busy. I am still learning to allow myself to say no to commitments, so I am able to excel at my chosen commitments. I have grown through my experiences with 4-H. Though there have been many ups and downs, I have created my own path to success. Now I would like to pass it on to Logan and just sharing some of his experiences with 4-H.
Thank you so much, Hannah. And I hope you guys really got a lot out of everything Hannah said. There's some really great lessons in there from making sure you get out what you put in. Get out what you put in, and also just really making sure you don't, you know how to say no to things as well. And I think those are both really great lessons. I mentioned kind of briefly in my introduction that I have some experiences traveling, and I'd like to just give a bit more of a background of some of the things I've done with 4-H and outside of 4-H too that have led me to have such interest in international agriculture, and why I'm so excited to be able to talk to people all across the greater Americas today, be able to collaborate with people across the world. For myself, when I started 4-H, I was really excited to just get hands-on and learn about things locally, but pretty quickly I was able to start traveling as well with 4-H, which is one of the biggest things I've got out of the program. When I was just 12 years old, my first international trip was to Japan, which you can see on the far right here of this map. It was my first ever international trip, and I learned a lot. Having a homestay for 1 month with a family who had visited me the year before was an extraordinary experience, and really gave me that travel bug. And from that point on, I knew that I wanted to see as much of the world as I could. In 2016, I was selected as one of 10 4-H Canada members who traveled together in a group for another 1 month stay in Ghana in West Africa, which you can see in the middle of the screen here. And that was the second big trip that I'd taken ever, and both of them with through 4-H. There's also lots of other experiences in there traveling across the country, but this one really opened my eyes to giving back to 4-H. During the trip, we got to do lots of hands-on work with the 4-H program in Ghana, as their program focused on a lot of the same things that ours does in Canada, but was in the school system. We worked with schools directly, giving them suggestions of how to improve their program and run things, or give ideas of how we run things in Canada, I should say. And also during the trip, we had a long period of time where we were able to kind of see their different agricultural practices and the farms that they have there. It's a really great experience for me, as I hadn't ever seen tropical agriculture before. Growing up in Canada, we grow lots of corn and soybeans and wheat, and that's the main crops we grow. But in Ghana, the main thing they grow is cacao, or cocoa as we call it here in Canada, and it was a great opportunity to see different crops. That inspired me, and when I started my university career, I really wanted to get an opportunity to see more agriculture in different parts of the world. In 2017 is when I got my chance to be a youth advisor for Ontario, and during my first year, I was sent to the FFA, which is the Future Farmers of America, another organization similar to IICA and 4-H that works with agriculturally focused youth. And that conference was in Indianapolis, in Indiana, USA. It had 60,000 attendees, and it was an incredible experience to see just the scale of how many people had this same focus of wanting to become youth who are involved in their communities and really want to make the most of the learning opportunities available to them. In my university career, just this past February 2019, I should say, I took a tropical agriculture course in that winter semester. And part of the course was a field course part of it, which was a full 10 days in Costa Rica, which was just an incredible experience to learn more about crops that we can't grow here in Canada. We saw many, many different farms. We saw palm oil, pineapple, different fruit production, sugarcane, cacao, lots of things that we cannot grow here at all in Canada just because of our climate. As well, just the biodiversity in Costa Rica really amazed me. So all of you here living in Costa Rica and neighboring countries, just be very grateful for the amount of beautiful diversity you can see in your communities and in the countries you live in. It is really incredible, and it's still one of my favorite trips I've ever taken. I'm actually going to stand up here. I've been sitting all morning, so I hope you guys don't mind if I change my focus a little bit and kind of can move more freely. We'll kind of keep going. So hopefully that gives you a bit of an idea of some of my background and why I'm so passionate about international agriculture and youth engagement in communities. So why are youth communities so important? I think that all of us know that there's tons of benefits to youth being engaged in their communities, but to me, it really comes down to three things. Those are education, communication, and involvement. When youth get involved in their communities, they're taking opportunities to learn from everybody around them, and also just take in all the knowledge from the community that already exists. It's also giving them opportunities to learn about communication, talk to friends and talk about the issues that are affecting them. There's tons of things on youth minds these days, from their own issues of school and mental health to also greater things like what they're going to do with their careers and everything in the world around them. And youth really are interested. Giving those youth opportunities to talk about their thoughts on it is really important. It also just gives them more strength in communication. Becoming involved with programs like 4-H has really given me the ability to make presentations like this here today and not feel afraid of approaching people to communicate about whatever is on my mind. As well, just involvement in the community is really important. It really helps the whole community feel more energized, like everybody is taking part in the community. And that's one of the greatest parts about 4-H is that 4-H youth really do make a difference in the communities they live in. And so what does this all come back to? I'm just going to stand back a bit here so people can see me better. I think it really comes back to the next generation. That's always been a bit of a strong point in my family. And coming up here right now is my grandfather. And he's one of the people who kind of instilled that idea of it's all about the next generation. He was really great and a very passionate farmer. But what he was most passionate about was providing for his own kids and his grandchildren. And I'm really lucky that he was able to instill those same morals in myself and in my parents. For him, he was involved politically and encouraged everybody to get out and vote. And that's one of his greatest accomplishments in his life, I think, was being so passionate. But also, when he was encouraging people to vote, he was always encouraging them to think about what politicians were doing for the next generation. He knew that he never wanted to take anything out of the community, but he knew he could if the next generation was able to provide. And so he always wanted to focus things on like education in the community, building strong families, and giving opportunities for the next generation to move into business and farming and things like that. He himself was a dairy farmer too and worked really hard his whole life. And this picture here is actually on the wedding day of one of his daughters. And just his commitment to the next generation, you can see the importance of being able to feed a calf no matter what else was going on that day. He really believed that the next generation was our greatest resource. So when you're thinking about building strong youth communities, to me it's really about having youth first. It's all that mindset of youth have to be engaged, they have to be part of it. And so in this picture you can see I'm having a little bit of fun at a 4-H event, and it's actually with my grandfather from the other side of my family, and I'm really lucky to have both of them have such strong influence on my life as they were both have taught me great life lessons. This grandfather has really taught me about having fun and being enthusiastic about everything you do. It's really an important thing to make sure that people are engaged and having fun with what they're doing. He always said that if you're having fun with what you're doing, everybody's more likely to give back and really want to be part of what you're doing. And so that really, when you're thinking about youth programming, that really just shows that if you get youth interested, if you get them excited about whatever you're doing, it really just kind of adds to that element of people wanting to become engaged. It helps make youth feel involved as well. The biggest thing in youth organizations is to make sure that youth are wanting to become engaged and they're focusing on things that matter to them. When I became a 4-H member, we kind of had limited clubs and projects that we could take in our local club. It was mostly focused on dairy, which goes back to my dairy background and my agricultural background, but I definitely wanted to get more out of the program, as did other youth who were involved. There was a group of us who were really interested in square dancing, actually, and though our leaders didn't know a lot about it, they took it upon themselves to really make sure that we were able to learn about things important to us. That way, we could get the most out of the program. And as well, on the last slide, there was just a brief thing about making youth feel safe. And if youth feel safe, they know that that club belongs to them. And that's just a really important thing to make sure that. For me, I felt safe joining the 4-H club because my grandfather had been in it, my parents had, so I'm the third generation. I knew I belonged there, but for other members in our club, they were the first people from their family, and it was up to myself to make sure, and the leaders to make sure, that they felt like the club belonged to them as well. It wasn't just for people who had been in the 4-H program before, that they could come into the program and get as much out of it as we did. So going back to that, once youth feel involved and they feel like they can make choices about what's going on in their youth communities, they go from being a member to kind of an owner of that program. And so that's what I'm going to talk about a little bit here. As I mentioned, we started out square dancing, and on the left two pictures, you can see myself in a couple square dancing competitions. When I was really just at an amateur level, I felt like I was learning a lot, but I definitely was a member, and I wasn't making any big progress to advance square dancing for other people. But as I moved on to university, I actually joined a square dancing set of people who were in their fourth year of university while I was just in my first semester. And it really showed me that they had probably 3 years more of experience in their square dancing careers, but I was keeping up with them and even teaching them new things. After that semester, I was able to create a square dancing set of people my age, and we really took ownership of what we thought square dancing was and really made lots of advancements for our own set. We had a lot of success with it, and because we were able to take ownership and do things that other square dancing sets were, we felt like we were advancing the square dancing community in Ontario as we were creating new moves and new dances that nobody had done before. And it was really that first few steps of learning square dancing in 4-H and being a member that really developed into that ownership of square dancing for all of us. I talked a little bit earlier just kind of about my travels and how much it's important to make connections. I've made connections through everything I've done in the 4-H program, and some of them have really come back to help me a lot along the way. It's important to think about every connection you make, even at competitions like this, if it's in a virtual setting. Everyone that you meet really is a resource to you, and you want to make sure that you get as much out of that as you can. And it's important to keep in touch in any way you can. In this picture here, I'm standing with a senator who in the Canadian government, whose name is Rob Black, and he's a great promoter for 4-H. He really supports 4-H in everything he does, always broadcasts our name anytime he gets the opportunity to, and is a great face for 4-H. 2 years ago, this is at an event on our Parliament Hill at the Canadian government, and I had the chance to meet him, and he was really enthusiastic about the 4-H program, and I could tell that right away, and he got that same feeling for me. So we had this great connection and bond right away. It was a great opportunity to kind of get to know him. And moving on from that, I've actually run into him a ton of more times at different events. After that event, I was able to do an interview with him over the phone, and I wrote an article for one of our 4-H Canada magazines about his 4-H experience as he was a member about 30 years ago. And then from that, I've run into him at different agricultural events as he's a big promoter for agriculture as well. And I've even been able to lean on him a bit as well, as in my university time, we were looking for a speaker for an event, and I thought he would be the perfect fit. And he was able to come and talk about his university experience and how that has got him to where he is today in the Canadian government. In today's world, it's very easy to keep up with different connections. On this slide are just some of the connections I've made through my university career, through 4-H, many different things. And with great social media platforms like LinkedIn and Instagram, WhatsApp, and Twitter, there's so many ways that you can keep in contact with people. So, and it's just important to note that every event or every person you meet could be a resource to you as you go forward. As I was planning for this presentation, I wanted to touch up on my knowledge of the 4-H program in Central America. And so one of the guys you can see kind of on the top left, he actually went to Costa Rica on a 4-H exchange. So even though I hadn't seen him in 3 years, he was still a 4-H connection, and I just reached out to him over Instagram. And Instagram might be a platform you don't generally think is for communicating as much as it is for seeing pictures, but just through a quick Instagram message, he got back to me within about an hour, and it just goes to show that no matter how you are connected, make sure that you get that connection first, but don't ever be afraid to use it. All these people on the screen, I've reached out to for different things over the past, and when I met them, I wouldn't necessarily have thought that they might be a connection, but they really became valuable ones for myself at different times. So once you've made all these connections, it's really important to rely on them, but I forgot what's on the slide. All right, so so in this slide here is actually one of my favorite 4-H memories. And so I talked about kind of having ownership over the program, but in this picture here is one of my favorite 4-H memories of my first national conference I attended, members forum in, I think it was 2015, so quite a while ago now. But there's 80 people, and it was my first experience of getting together with youth from across the country, 80 participants all across Canada who came together for this members forum. And out of the 80 people here, I still have great connections with, I would say, at least 40 of them, and could rely on them for anything I need if I shot them a message over LinkedIn, Twitter, whatever it is. They're all great connections. But how much I got out of this event members forum, I have used the lessons I learned at this members forum for the past 5 years now. And for myself in the 4-H program, I was definitely a member when I attended this, but I was really able to give back to it this past year when I attended as a facilitator. And so there was 80 youth again, except I was helping run the event this time. And with youth three or four years younger than me, you can see in this picture some of them here. It was a great experience for me to really give back and give back to that next generation, take ownership of the 4-H program, and make sure that they were getting out the same lessons that I got out of it. So in 4-H, we do so much about learning to lead and making an impact on your community. But it's really important that once you do learn to lead, that you actually do it. And so at this members forum that I went to in 2015, that was one of the main focuses, was developing your leadership potential. And then this past year, going as a facilitator and one of the people organizing it, I really was able to put all of those lessons I learned into action and be a great leader. This picture here is also just kind of a next step for me, and also showing that I am giving back to the people who are coming up in the program after me. So in this picture, you can see me in the bright green 4-H suit right there, and almost everybody else in that picture are members at the National Members Forum, and I could just see the great leadership potential in them and how much they were getting out of it, and that they had that same excitement and enthusiasm that I did 5 years ago. But also in this picture is John Herdman, who is the national soccer coach for Canada. I'm a big soccer fan, and I've grown up playing soccer. And to meet him in person was an incredible experience. He's a person who I really admire in his coaching abilities and everything he does in the community. I can remember growing up watching the Canadian women's soccer team and just thinking about how impressed I was with the way he conducted himself as a coach, as a leader in the community. And so at this members forum, I was able to give an address to a crowd of people, about 500 people at this conference of one of 4-H Canada's partners, CropLife Canada. And taking up this stage was an incredible experience to really show everything that I've learned in the 4-H program. But even more incredible of the experience was John Herdman was the speaker taking the stage right after me. And he was the keynote speaker, and I had the chance to meet him that day. And I immediately was just telling him about how much I feel like I look up to him, and he's a person who's I really admire. And he said the same thing about how he sees the leadership potential in myself and all of the 4-H members there. And so it really was just an eye-opening experience that somebody who is so successful in their life really sees that the next generation coming up in myself and these other 4-H members is also has the great leadership potential from becoming involved in their community. And so although moving on from my membership of 4-H, as this is my last year, to kind of being more involved at a greater level, the way we are involved in communities really changes, but it's really still important to have fun. And you can see here in the picture on the right, how much fun myself and some other 4-H leaders are still having. And both these pictures are things I wouldn't have normally done as a 4-H member when I started out my 4-H career. On the left is a picture of that FFA conference in Indiana. And there's myself and one other 4-H member there who are able to be presenters and kind of give back to the next generation of FFA members. And it was a great experience. We had a ton of fun there. And so it's important that even as you move on into leadership positions, you're still taking it out of the experiences as much as you can. And in this picture on the right is actually, you would think from the picture we're having a ton of fun, which we are, but the conference we're at is actually 4-H Ontario's annual general meeting, which is usually a lot of policy and really serious stuff, kind of stuff that will put you to sleep. But it's important that we both get that work done, but you can see all the people who are in that picture with me are leaders I've had, and we all still know how to have fun. And even though what we're doing, the program's changed, we still know how to have fun and be engaged in the 4-H program. So the big take-home messages I want to kind of get at are be able to have fun, and also those connections, like make sure the youth in your programs are having fun, but make all the connections you use will become really helpful to you. So for myself, absolutely feel free to contact me, reach out to me, follow me on Instagram, Twitter. There's great ways of keeping in touch. There's some of my social media handles, because for all I know, I might rely on some of you someday as a great connection if I have another presentation to make or if I'm traveling again. And same for you, if you ever have questions for me, I'm a great connection to have, and I'm your resource now. So make sure to use all those connections that you make along your way and to your full advantage. Every person you meet is a resource to you. So with that, I'd just like to thank you all for participating with us today. Hopefully we have a few questions about anything, and thanks to everybody for joining us virtually today. So
yes, thank you so much.
Wow, fue una gran presentación, definitivamente.
What a good presentation. You definitely have a great wealth of experience in network building and also in personal areas of your lives to be part of this network of young people. We have a lot of questions. The first one is, how do you promote participation by young women? This is because parents tend to be more protective of their daughters when they want to participate or travel. So how do you handle that? Do you want me to read several questions or all of them, and then we can get back, and then you can answer them all at once?
Sure.
Or should we do one at a time?
Maybe if you, you can read them out as they come, and we will give us just a bit more time to think about the answers we're going to give, and maybe split up the questions between the two of us, who's going to answer what.
Yeah.
Yeah, pues. Perfecto. Bueno, esa es la
That's
primera.
Good. So that was the first question. The next one is this. What about young people who want to continue, but they've outgrown it? They're no longer young. They've aged out. Next question. Young women who have children, can they continue being part of 4-H? Next. The next question. All of this about travel is great, sounds nice, but what else might encourage people to be in an organization and to stay there? What achievements have you been able to build with other young people? How do you do it? And what is the committee for, the YAC? What's that for?
Maybe we'll start answering some of them just while they're kind of fresh in our minds. I don't know if you want to take any of them yet, Hannah.
Because my
laptop just showed me I have a low battery, so I'm going to have to move. But if you want to, maybe we'll start answering a couple of them so we're not fully swamped by so many.
Yeah. Logan, do you want me to start or do you want to start?
Yeah, if you could. I'm going to need to just move quickly and connect myself to a charger.
Okay, sounds good. So one of the questions was about if women have young children and how they can stay involved in the 4-H program. So we do have an age range for 4-H members, and that ranges from 6 to about 21 to 25, depending what province and what type of project. That's for 4-H members, and that's the youth. And then once you age out of the program, you can still be involved. There are different ways of being involved, by volunteering and by being a leader. A leader is the main thing that is like the glue of our program. These leaders help guide the 4-H members. As we mentioned, our motto, learn to do by doing. Yes, like we try to guide the 4-H members to be independent and to have it, like, do their projects, which it can be what they choose, but there is always the need for a little guidance, a push, or just someone to help out. So that's what the leaders are for, and they're like the base of any club meeting. They help guide and help the members learn so they can be independent and learn from the 4-H program.
I'll just jump in there a bit. And so that's a great kind of answer about the age range that you're able to be involved in 4-H, but it's really important to be involved in your community, I think, even outside of if you have a 4-H program or anything else like that, to create your own communities. There was a question of if women with children could still be involved in the 4-H program, and the answer to that is yes, but there's also other great organizations, and in your local community, I think it's really important to find people who have similar interests and want to learn about things that are similar to you, whether it's through a 4-H program or anything else. To stay involved in your community is a great way to kind of keep learning and also give back to your next generation. As well, I think there was another question about travel, and if you were that travel is great, but you're right that being involved in your local community is still kind of important, even if you aren't able to participate in travel opportunities. And so, yeah, if you've become involved in your local community, and there aren't as many great opportunities, it's still really important to your own community to kind of keep creating events, keep pushing to have involvement in your own community, I would say, to further your own knowledge of people in your community, but also give people in your community opportunities to be involved and have that sense of improving their education and their communication and things like that.
Yeah, and to add on to that, it's not all about travel. We have different pillars in 4-H that we do have different activities. We have healthy living, and we have sustainable agriculture, communications. So we have different avenues as well that members do not have to travel to participate in 4-H. So they can compete in public speaking or just learn how to speak in front of their like a group. And then we also do meetings. So these members learn about different like how to run a meeting and like Robert's rules. So they know how to make a motion or take minutes or act as the chair of the meeting. So and those are just like beneficial skills that you can take into any position in like your future job or in your community.
I think the final question that we haven't really touched on yet was asking about engaging women in communities, especially with parents who might have restrictions on who they're able to meet with or things like that. And so that is a very, I guess that's might be a bit more of a difficult topic for me to speak on, but I really think that becoming engaged in youth organizations really empowers young people, both men and women, to kind of break down barriers that are there already and really develop their own potential that they might not be able to with just inside their family. If you want to talk about that at all more, Hannah.
Yeah, and like with most organizations that I've been involved in and know of some others, is that parents are allowed to bring the kids that aren't actually enrolled in that program as well along. So in 4-H, for me, when I was growing up, it was about almost a big family. Like everybody brought their siblings. I know because I'm an only child, it was just my mom and I, but there was cousins that would come and everything. So it was a whole big family. There was kids that were 3-4 years old. So they weren't old enough to be part of the 4-H program, but they still came around. Like they were a pre-4-H member. And like we would have our meeting. And then after, we would head to our local ice cream place and have ice cream after. So everybody was always involved.
We'll take a few more questions here for sure. I think it's valuable, as many questions as we can answer for everybody.
Sí, pero antes quedaba una pregunta que había.
Before we do that, there was a question, okay. Which is, what is the determining factor to get young people involved in their communities?
Oh, yes. So part of what I talked about is finding things that people are really interested in. And so I think that's the really important thing is people aren't going to, youth aren't going to become engaged in communities if the communities aren't focusing on things that youth want to focus on. So if you are a leader who's wanting to start an organization, I suppose, or looking to get youth engaged, I think it's important to reach out to the youth you're wanting to involve and find out what they want to learn about, what are the issues that really matter to them. And I feel like that's the biggest thing. I know that youth, especially today, I think might need a bit of an extra boost to really encourage them to become involved and really get out there and do things. And whether it's a boost from their friends, from their own family, I know I was excited to join 4-H because my family did, but there are families who say, oh no, that's just what our family does. You need to go out there and do it. Whatever that boost needs to be to get people involved is really important, but youth will really jump on anything that's of interest to them, I think.
Yeah, I totally agree. And just have it for youth to have a goal and to work towards that goal and not to have a goal that's set by someone else. Because I know for me, if someone else would set that goal, I would probably do totally the opposite thing. So I think setting your own goals and just making them feel welcome, that's another thing that I think was very beneficial in what I have leaned towards for organizations to be involved in, is if I feel welcomed, if I feel that I can speak and have a voice and make sure my opinions get heard in the way I want people to hear them. I think that's major for getting youth involved. That's just, yeah, something that I find that has worked for me and I think is kind of similar for other youth as well.
Sí, absolutamente. En el sondeo que nosotros...
That's right. We did a survey here at ICA among young people, and in fact, this was one of the most important features that we heard about rural youth communities. They're also asking, they asked what the youth committee was for. And here's another one.
But we'll go through a few more too, yeah.
This is the last one.
Okay. Logan, do you want to start?
Okay, yeah. So the Youth Advisory Committee specifically, it is set up by 4-H Canada to make sure that youth who are still members have a voice at the national level. So 4-H Canada has lots of staff. They have lots of leaders and volunteers who have their own ideas about how the 4-H program should be running, what youth are interested in. But the Youth Advisory Committee is really to make sure that the program is focused on issues that matter to youth. I think it helps keep things fresh and make sure that 4-H is staying on trend with what people are wanting to learn about, but also to make sure that programming is run in ways that is accessible to youth, and promoting the ways that 4-H youth are able to engage with materials, things like that. There's also other things that the Youth Advisory Committee partakes in, and we touched on them a bit. Do you want to talk about any of the conferences and stuff, Hannah?
Yeah, so we have different conferences. So we meet in person because YAC live across the country. So we meet in person once a year, and that is at our leadership summit. And we get to moderate pretty much the whole summit and network with different 4-H leaders and different 4-H staff and get to talk about what's happening in our provinces, as each province is a tiny bit different than the other. So like different projects to how just the 4-H program is run. So then to bring it all to 4-H Canada and just say what's happening in our province, what's going on. And then the other thing I just want to touch on is just like the hierarchy of 4-H. So like we start in our clubs, so that's where all the 4-H members are. And then we go to our district. So that's just like moving out to a little bit larger area, adding in more clubs into that district. Then our region is like, for me, it's the Kootenays. So that's like all the clubs. So that's like about 6 or 7 in all of my area. And then we go provincially, and that's all the clubs provincially. So that's Then the provincial level, they have different activities that they bring the whole province together. And that's where most 4-H members have their programs, and like they go to different camps. And then there's a select few that go to national conferences, like the ones that we mentioned. And then there's a select few, the 10 of us that are the YAC, that bring all our voice, all the 4-H members' voices from each province, bringing them to 4-H Canada to say what's happening in our provinces and what we would like to see improved or what's working very well for our province. Yeah, so that's a little bit more about what YAC do.
De acuerdo. Muchas gracias.
Very good. Thank you. Last question. What mechanisms do you use to disseminate information about 4-H Canada and its actions?
So for ourselves, I think both of us use social media to kind of talk about how we are involved in the program. But 4-H Canada itself is... it has its own website that you can find, and depending on your country, you might be able to even find their 4-H websites. But 4-H Canada is also on Instagram. It's on Facebook, where it shares lots of materials about what they're doing. You could probably also access program materials from 4-H Canada if you're wanting to look at how we run things here. You can access those materials on their website and kind of run programming in your own countries or your own communities if you'd like to that way. I think there's a lot of great resources there.
Yes, and I think to add on to Logan's point, 4-H Learns is actually up and running, and it's a website, and it combines all different programming, all different resources from all the different 4-H communities from Canada to all around the world as well. So you can access all of that as well. And it's called 4-H Learns.
Perfect. Yeah, if we could maybe get the 4-H Learns website, we'll send an email about it and we can send that out to all the participants on this video if people have more questions.
De acuerdo. No, creo que sería las últimas preguntas ya.
No, I think those are the last questions. So all we have left to do now is thank you for all of your hard work. We know that also all of our participants and we ourselves on the coordinating team all went to bed late last night getting your presentation ready. I know we did. So thank you. Thank you so much. And for those who have joined us, the participants, keep in mind all of this information that they told us today. It's relevant to all the presentations we've had and all the lectures. Use that information. We talked about governance. We talked about how to create a community. We talked about the elements for graphic identification, virtual mechanisms, all the diversity. All the things we're doing in our project. You were talking about 4-H Canada. It's a very heterogeneous country. You have all those provinces. They're all different. Thank you for your attention and enjoy the rest of the day.
Thank you, everybody.
A los participantes, solo recuerden que nos vemos.
To the participants, please remember that we will be back at 2:00 this afternoon for our final lecture for today.
Buenas tardes.
Good afternoon.
Gustavo, ¿cómo estás? Muchas gracias.
Hola, Gustavo, ¿todo bien?
Pura vida, gracias a Dios. Norbin, muchas gracias. Yo creo que ya estamos y que tengan buen día. Chao, chao.